my disability is called osteogenesis imperfecta, better known as brittle bone disease, and I didn't want to be relying on another adult in me becoming an adult. So Nerf is really great on campus. I'm running a little late. He's a pull dog, so I can grab onto his vest and tell him to pull and we'll zip off. And so he gives me that extra bit of speed that I may need. Canine Companions is just, everybody involved in this mission are just so special.
When a local college student with a rare disease is getting special assistance on campus from a very special dog.
ABC Action News reporter Sean Daly is at the University of Tampa, where a unique bond is helping a young woman achieve her dreams.
This is Leigh, a freshman at the University of Tampa. And this is Nerf, who's helping Leigh realize her dreams of becoming a nurse.
I was about 7 when I started saying I wanted to be a nurse. Told my parents that when I went off to college, I wanted to be independent. I wanted to be on my own.
Leigh has brittle bone disease. Her bones are prone to fracture, so she spent a lot of her 18 years in the hospital. Nerf is a 2-year-old golden lab mix from a nonprofit called Canine Companions for Independence. He's been trained to help with Leigh's specific needs at college.
He's considered a pull dog, so he has a strap on the back of his harness that I can grab onto it when we're going, and he'll actually pull me in my wheelchair, and so we get a little bit quicker pace. He's also a retrieve dog, so if I drop my keys, if I drop my pencil, my water bottle, you name it, he'll pick them up for me, and he'll just sit there and hold them until I get them back.
Nerf has done his job. He's kept Leigh safe and injury-free on campus, and he's getting this nursing major to class on time.
How are you doing so far?
4.0.
Really? 4.0?
I only have 1 semester on my belt, and, you know, I'm on my second, but yeah, 4.0 so far.
That's great. Wow.
In Tampa, Sean Daly, ABC Action News.
Cool. All right, so everybody, thanks so much for listening to Fire, Breathe, and Rob. We interview amazing people that do amazing things all across the country and even all across the world. We've had people. So thanks so much for listening. If you're listening for the first time, please like, subscribe, and share this podcast. This is $0. We're not making any money off this. We're just trying to get these stories out there of these amazing people. So please subscribe, like, and definitely share this video. Now, as we get kicking into the video, I'm very happy to have this person on. We've talked on and off a little bit about the CCI in general, and I'm happy to have her on. For people that don't know, before I introduce her, CCI is Canine Companions for Independence. It's a service dog organization that really helps people in need. That, you know, and it's helped my family a lot. Obviously, it's helped this person that we're going to bring on in just a second. But it's an amazing organization. Definitely look it up at cci.org. I hope you do. And if you do have a couple of bucks, it's really an organization that helps many people. And definitely shoot a couple bucks if you can to them. This is Leigh Dittman here. And she has a CCI dog, a beautiful dog that she'll be talking about in just a second and how CCI has affected her life. But first of all, I want to welcome you to the podcast, Leigh. Thanks so much for coming on. Greatly appreciate your time today.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for inviting me. I know we've been trying to set this up for almost a year now, but we finally had time in our schedules that fit, and I really appreciate it.
Well, I know you're a college student going to University of Tampa, so obviously college comes first, and I know it's a new and crazy experience for all of us in college, especially throughout COVID. So I appreciate you taking the time here to do this. So when did you hear about Canine Companions for Independence, Leigh?
Yeah, so I was attending a regional conference for my disability. I have osteogenesis imperfecta, better known as brittle bone disease, when I was like 12, I think. And there was a woman with the same condition giving a talk about Canine Companions and how she's experienced going through the system and has received, I think she's on her 3rd dog now. Wow. From Canine Companions. So she was giving a presentation about them, showed the different commands that her dog could do. And I was sitting there in the crowd and I was like, oh my gosh, I want this. I'd always wanted a dog and my parents had always said no. So I was like, okay, here's my in, because this dog will help me, but it's also like a dog, it's a pet. So I'm like, oh my gosh, best of both worlds. So I just fell in love instantly. And so afterwards, I went up to her and we were talking. She let me meet her dog His name's Lloyd, and he's retired now. But he was just so sweet, and he was so gentle with her, and for us with brittle bone disease, obviously that's really important. And so that was something that I was like, okay, these dogs are really well trained. And so I started kind of the convincing process with my parents, and it took a couple years. And then they finally said yes. So I started the application process when I was like 14, 15.
So can you talk about this? So I know with a lot of people, my family was one of the lucky ones as far as getting, and the waiting list for this is so long at times, and it's very hard to get one of these dogs. It's not just some, you pay money and you get it. And we'll talk about the cost in just a second about this. But, talk about your time, 15 or 16, you applied for this dog. Did you get off the waiting list quick? Was it a long wait for you? How did all that go?
I started the application process. I was 15. And it starts with the preliminary application of the, like, are you interested and do we think we can help you application. And then once they approve you, you get the real application, have to fill that out, basically tell them your whole life story, show them your whole life, send pictures of your house, your family, the yard, everything. And then they do a phone interview. If they like you, then they invite you for the in-person one. So I did my in-person interview January 2017, and then got on the wait list in February and got the call that I was attending training June 2018, so for the July group. So it was about 18 months from the time I was placed on the waiting list to the time I entered team training.
Can we talk about the training?
Yeah, so I got the call, like I said, in June, and I was actually at the hospital for like some routine, like checkups and appointments and things, when I got the email came across first, and I literally like screamed, started crying, and like a nurse came flying in the room and was like, what's wrong? And I was like, I just got the call. Like, I'm going for my service dog in 2 months. And of course everyone's like celebrating because they've known me my whole life and they knew that this was happening. So it was a big deal. And it was like the weekend before my birthday, basically, when I got the notification. Oh yeah. I was like, so jazzed. So then it becomes the prep work of, okay, I need to do the team phone call where they kind of say, here's a general idea of what to expect, be prepared, here's what we're asking you to do before you get here, here's what to expect once you get here, are you still good with this, can you make travel arrangements, all those sorts of things have to be done before you're anywhere near ready to come in. Right. So go through that whole process. I was invited for the July training that goes, the end of July into the first week of August. So technically we're considered like the August class. Mm-hmm. And my mom went with me. My mom stayed with me because I think all of the regions, I might be mistaken, but I think all of the regions for Canine Companions have on-campus housing. So
right. I know the Northeast does.
Yeah, we stayed on Southeast campus. They basically have these wonderful, completely ADA compliant apartments, basically, for you to stay in. So my mom went with me, and we were there for 2 weeks. We have a weekend break in the middle of it that we actually got to come home, and I actually got to bring Nerf home with me during that middle break because we live so close, which was really cool and kind of helped a little bit with that adjustment. We were still in training. I was still getting used to him, but I was able to bring him home to kind of our environment and say, okay, here's a taste of what it'll be like before actually having to do it. So it's intense. Training is a lot. These dogs have been trained for 2 years basically before they ever get to their final person, but you as the human know nothing. You don't know any of their command words. You don't know anything about the roles and expectations other than kind of what you've seen as an outsider and what you assumed would work well for you. And now in training, you're finding out if that's actually the case. For example, Nerf is a pull dog. So he actually is able to pull me in my manual chair with his larger vest. He wears the wider one with the pull strap on the middle of them compared to the flat ones, the smaller ones. And so that was something that I was really interested in, wanted to be able to have a dog that had that ability. But it means that typically those dogs spend more time in training. So it means you're waiting longer to get those dogs. And so I was like, I don't need it. If I can get it, cool. But I don't have to have it. I really just wanted the dog at that point. But it worked out where Nerf was pull dog trained and is a pull dog. But trying that for the first couple times during training was a lot. It's a little intimidating and scary because you're trusting this dog to behave and do it how they're supposed to. And, you know, for me, it's the factor of like, if I fall out of my chair, it's not going to be as calm of a situation as somebody else. You know, there's an added fear factor to it. And so that was definitely intimidating, but we got the hang of it. He's great at it. He has the energy for it, but he's not a super rambunctious dog. Like, you can see him right now. He's laying on my bed, literally passed out. You know, like, he's a very gentle dog unless it's he's working, and then he's all in. And that was something that I noticed right away in his training was he was so gentle and sweet when it was just like time to relax, but when it was time to perform, he really has the energy and the excitement for it and does it.
Leigh Dittman here on Fire Breathing Rob. On that stage, can you just talk about the graduation, how emotional it was for you, your family, and Nerf and his puppy Razor, of course?
Yeah, so what's nice is Southeast actually kind of makes it a whole day. For graduation, they start it very early in the morning. We as graduates are meant to take the dogs to the kennel like first thing in the morning so that they can get all prim and proper and prettied up. But they also get to spend about an hour with their puppy raisers. So graduates are totally out of the picture. We're not anywhere near them. We're off getting ourselves together. And the puppy raiser has complete one-on-one time with the dogs that they've raised. And it could be, you know, 6 to 9 months since the last time they saw them. So they get to have a moment with them, and then the dogs will go back with the trainers, and they end up kind of shuffling the puppy raisers into a different room on the campus. And we graduates meet them in that room for a breakfast. So we get to meet prior to actually going through graduation. So we don't know who anybody is. They don't know what we look like yet. We know what they look like because the day before, the trainers actually show them in like a little slideshow. So then, of course, those of us that are like nosy start like trying to find them on like Facebook and stuff. And so I actually ended up finding mine on Facebook before I met her. So I kind of knew who I was looking for. But you walk into this room and it's like a family reunion is what you see kind of happening with perfect strangers. You know, you've never met before, you've never seen each other, but you're connected by this dog that, you know, they've loved on them for, you know, 18 months as puppies. And you as the graduate have only known the dog 2 weeks and you're completely obsessed with them. You know, you love them as if you've had them their whole life. So you walk into this room, and I'm a big crier, so just throwing that out there now. We walk into the room and I see Annemiek with her husband, and we start walking towards each other. And she just instantly starts hugging me as soon as we get close enough. And we're both crying at this point and like haven't even said hello yet. We're literally just crying on each other. And she's like, I'm so happy that Nerf is with somebody that I can tell just loves him instantly, because, you know, Nerf is her fourth dog that she's raised. And now she's on six. So she's raised two since Nerf already. But Nerf is the one that she said, not that as a puppy raiser you wish this, but you secretly do, that they don't make it through training. You want them to come home. And Nerf was hers. Nerf wanted to, she wanted Nerf to come home to her. She had the plans of if he didn't pass, if he didn't make a match, she'd keep him. And she told me that that was the case. And she said that she was so glad that he found me instead. That if anybody could have had him, she was glad it was me. So of course I'm sitting there like bawling my eyes out. I'm like, you're so wonderful. Like, we've never met before. You've loved on this dog. You're giving him away. Like, how, like, you're an amazing person for doing this. And so once we've like gotten through it, we're like, hi, you know, I'm Leigh. I'm Anna Meek. Like, nice to actually meet you now that we've had all this moment together. We sit and we have breakfast. And so I tell her my life story. You know, I tell her that, you know, I just graduated high school. I'm going into college in the next 2 weeks. I want to be a nurse. I'm going into nursing school. You know, this is my mom, you know, my dad and my sisters and my grandma. You'll meet them at graduation. You know, like, just telling my life story. And she's just crying as we're talking. You know, she's laughing, she's crying, and she's just like, this is so perfect. And she's like, as a puppy raiser, this is what you hope for, is somebody who will benefit from the dog that you've put so much time and energy into, but also like loves them. You know, it's not, you don't just see them as a piece of medical equipment that, you know, service dogs are in reality. You know, they're medical equipment for those of us with disabilities, realistically, but they're living, breathing, beautiful creatures as well. And it's having that balance. And, you know, we just sat and we talked about everything. She told me about her family. And then of course that goes by so quickly. And then it's like, okay, everybody has to get into their cars and head to the graduation site. So you go there, and, you know, of course I'm seeing my dad and my sisters for the first time in like 2 weeks, really. 'Cause like, yeah, I came home in the middle weekend, but Nerf and I were like locked in my room. We didn't leave. We didn't see anybody. 'Cause that's what that middle weekend is for bonding. And so like, my family got to like come in, do like a quick like pet pet and then leave. And that was pretty much it. It was just us two. So I really hadn't seen anybody in 2 weeks other than my mom. So you do that, and then you sit with all of your like classmates basically. And I'm sitting with a friend that I made through class, Tanner, who was a few years older than me. We were like the youngest young adults in the group. There were like a bunch of little kids, and then there were like older people and like facility dog recipients. Yeah. So we were the only ones that were like between the ages of 18 and like 24. So we clicked, but we're sitting together, and I mean, I can't even remember the ceremony really. I was such a like high on adrenaline and just like excitement, and the whole thing is just a blur. And next thing you know, it's your turn to go up on stage, and you know, you're hearing it in the background as they're talking about you and like how great you were in training and how great the team is and yada, yada, yada. And like, you're not registering any of it. You're just watching the puppy raiser as they're coming up from the other side. You're seeing your dog, and the dog is excited to see you. You know, they're pulling to you. And that's how you know that you are a match, that you are a team now, is here they are with somebody that they were with for 18 months, and they're excited for you, the person that they've only known 2 weeks. And they do the classic ceremonial passing of the leash. You know, you do another set of hugs, and then off you go again on the stage, and then you blink and it's over. And now you have this dog that you are solely responsible for, and a new friendship for life with the puppy raiser. And it's just a really surreal feeling that you don't appreciate until you go to following graduations that aren't your own, and you can watch it and it's not you. You know, you see it as the outsider of watching the next people get their dogs and the same reactions and emotions, and actually getting to listen to the words when people are talking and being like, oh, that's the nice things that they say. Don't have any memory of it from my own. So it's something that I love, going to the graduations. I've been to two since getting Nerf. I probably would have been to more if it wasn't for COVID and everything. But it's something that I want to go to more of them. And of course I'll use the excuse of mom, dad, we gotta go because Anna Meek's turning in another dog, we have to see her, and you know, framing it as that way. But it's such a beautiful, unique experience that you really don't know what it's like unless you've been through it.
Now, does she live around here in Florida, or is she from a different state?
She's in Atlanta. She's a vet in Atlanta. So Nerf grew up like around animals and creatures and all of it. So he's very friendly with everything. And I think part of that is the fact that he was raised one in a house full of dogs, because she has like three of her own. Then himself. And then when she had the puppy that she was starting to work with right at the end of his kind of puppy raising experience. So he's just always been around animals when he was, I guess, growing up. And now he's just, he's a single dog in my household, so he's spoiled as all can be. But no, she's not local, unfortunately.
So Leah, let's talk about this. So now you have Nerf, you're going into college. How was the adjustment going into college? I'm sure you were a big hit on the Tampa campus over there. It's a beautiful campus. It almost looks like a Russian building. That's what I thought when I visited. Anyway, I'll let you get into it. So.
Yeah, it was a huge adjustment. It was a lot of new things all at once. The fact of having Nerf, I've never had a dog before. I've never had pets before. So that was a huge learning curve, was, okay, how do I take care of this breathing, living being that is as big as me and like make sure that he's okay? And my uncle's wife or girlfriend at the time works for a vet. So I was texting her like every other day of like, is this right? Is this normal? Is he okay? Like, I had no idea. And so, you know, shout out to Melissa, because she probably answered, you know, enough questions to where I probably should have paid her if I had called an actual vet like I should have. But that was a big adjustment, was having him. And then 2 weeks later, I started college. So totally new campus, new experience, new environment. It was also my first time going anywhere by myself. I'm a commuter. So I actually, my mom drove me back and forth. I'm only about 20, 30 minutes away. But I didn't have my own car at the time. So she was driving me in for classes and then going to work and then picking me up and all that. So that was a new piece in the fact of it was just a different commuter route. But it was something that I, all through public school, kindergarten through senior year, had a one-on-one aide for school. So someone that went with me to all my classes, carried my book bag, opened doors, made sure I didn't like die in the hallways, because, you know, high school hallways are real narrow and people really like to take them up. So that was the biggest adjustment for me personally, was learning how to exist and go places by myself, because I'd never done that before. You know, as a high schooler, you know, you go with your friends to the mall and shops and things, but as a high schooler, you're not really like running errands on your own, really. And you're not alone in school often. And for me, because I had a one-on-one aide, I never walked to classes by myself. So that was such a bizarre thing that I had a really hard time with at first, of what do I do? Like, how do you walk by yourself? How do you not have like a conversation with somebody or have like a person to look at as you're going someplace? Like, how do you exist as an individual being? I'd never had that before, never had to learn that. So that was really hard. But Nerf kind of was that in between of like, obviously your dog's not going to have a conversation with you. We all think that they can, and we will act like they do, but you know, he's not going to talk back at me. But I kind of used Nerf as my, almost like my security blanket, in the sense of when I felt like awkward or weird by myself, I'd talk to him of like, you know, good boy, come on, let's keep going. And, you know, like as you normally do with handling a dog, especially a service dog, you're meant to give them praise and keep them interested in what they're doing. But for me, I kind of took advantage of that as well. Of it made me feel more comfortable because it was giving me something to do as I was adjusting to this new experience. So it was something that I've obviously gotten better with time. Now we're going into our fourth and final year of college. So it's not a big deal now, but it at the beginning, it was rough. So he definitely made that easier than if I was completely on my own. So that was a unexpected bonus. You know, you're not anticipating that when you get a service dog, but it was something that I was really grateful for. But he is a hit on campus. Everybody loves him. especially now that I'm in like my nursing program, I've been in my program for a year and a half now. Sure. Everybody knows us. We're in this class of, you know, the same 40 people, basically 40, mm-hmm. 80 people. We have the same professors. So of course everyone knows us now and love Nerf. You know, they're always so excited. One of my professors, from my first semester is a big dog person. She loves dogs, has dogs herself. And so she was so sweet if she always would be like, Nerf is just a sigh of relief. Like, you're not allowed to touch him. You're not allowed to really talk to him. But just knowing that there's a dog in the room just relaxes you. And she said that in class. And so many people were like, yes. Like, I'm always excited when Leigh and Nerf are in the room, because even though I can't mess with Nerf, Nerf is there. Knowing that a dog is there is just something that people really like for some reason. And that professor pointed it out. And she's funny to the point where the following semester was Nerf's birthday's in March. And I had class on his birthday. And she actually, during like our mid-class break, ended up finding a birthday card and having it passed around the room. And it was a birthday card for Nerf. So I have a birthday card from my classmates that's for awesome. My dog, addressed to my dog. Comments are made to my dog of like, you're such a good boy. I love seeing you. You're so handsome. Like all of these things, like we love you, Nerf. And it literally, like, I almost teared up because my professors are all so supportive of me, but they also are so genuinely in love with Nerf. And respect to like our relationship, they don't mess with him unless they ask. And oftentimes I let my professors, because we're sitting talking anyways, most of the time. And so he'll be like, hello, you want to touch me? You want to say hello? And so I'll be like, it's okay. You can say hi to him. So they all have a relationship with him now too. But everybody loves him. They think he's amazing. So well-behaved. And of course I take zero credit for that, because, you know, he, as I like to say, he came programmed that way. You know, I think right. that Canine Companion dogs are so good. They're almost like they were programmed, but they're not Agreed. Living dogs.
Well, and, you know. Got to give the credit to where it's due, to the breed is, to the puppy raises.
Oh, yeah.
They're putting all their own money into these dogs and they have them, you know, ready to rock and roll when, you know, people like I said, with my sister, like you, that get these dogs, they're ready to go. They're not, you know, there's no issues. They're ready. They're programmed to go. So I agree with you 100%. Leigh Dittman here on Fire Breathing Rob. Leigh, I want to talk about with the last few questions. Obviously, we know COVID-19 was this year. It was a difficult year for everybody, whether you got sick, you have a family member that got sick, there was deaths around there too. With that said, we've heard a lot of people that have suffered from mental health issues throughout COVID-19. I'll even say myself, it's been hard. You know, somebody that like me, I used to go to Disney almost every night. I used to go and work out in the gym every day. And then all of a sudden everything's done and you're stuck at home, and it just kind of wears you down. It's worn me down personally. So how did COVID affect you and also Nerf?
Right. Yeah. We were told to not come back to school mm-hmm. during our spring break. We were told, you know, don't come back for 2 weeks. We'll see how things are. We'll go from there. And then, of course, by the end of the first week, that 2 weeks, we're like, no, don't come back for the rest of the semester. So that was a huge adjustment, because that was my first semester of nursing school. So at UT specifically, we have three semesters to do like our prerequisite classes. Mm-hmm. And then the following five semesters, once you're accepted into the program, are the nursing program. So this was, COVID hit my spring of my sophomore year. So it was my first semester of the nursing program. And that's a big adjustment to start the very intense classes that are nursing school. They're a lot of work and a lot of time. And to go from intense lectures to, okay, everything is remote now, was a lot. It was a big adjustment. And I don't think Nerf cared, honestly. I think a lot of our pets and animals are like, oh, cool, we don't have to go anywhere. Sounds good to me. So I don't think Nerf was too upset about it. I think he missed his friends. He loves a lot of my friends from school. So I think he was upset that he missed out on them. But I don't think he was upset about not going to class per se, because we stayed home. I think he was fine with it. I was not. I missed seeing people, and nursing school was hard online. You know, I picked an in-person program for a reason, and so to go from that to online was a lot. And I'm grateful that we're back in person. We've been in person since the fall. We've been in person pretty much this whole time, other than that initial, like,
is this just the nursing school or is this everybody at UT?
Pretty much everybody at UT. We're a small private university, so we don't have a big student body. A lot of our classes were kind of this hybrid situation where half the class was in person one day of the week and then the other half was online, and then we flipped on the back half. So my bigger nursing classes even did that. But this semester I was in smaller classes, so I was in person every day, which I was grateful for. But Nerf did fine. He liked it, I think. The bad thing was when we started going back in person, I could tell that it was kind of hard to get back in work mode. Just because of the fact of not constantly having his vest on and the expectation of you lay here and you stay here until you're told otherwise kind of had slipped a little bit. But I had a good kind of transition period of I was working in the office of orientation last summer. So when we started going back in person, we were only in the office with like five people. So it was a good way for him to kind of get back into the rhythm versus being thrown right back into school and classes and everyday routines. It was a little bit more of a, we're slowly getting back into it, you know, but
right.
I mean, it was a lot. I was grateful for having Nerf. You know, I think our fur friends are great emotional support for us, whether they are trained for it or not. So it was nice to have a dog that kind of gave me a reason to walk away from the computer and go do something else, or, you know, on days that it was a little rough, just kind of be in the moment and present with him was nice and a good break, and something that I know we as a family kind of were like, okay, cool, we're gonna love on the dog for a while if it's something that we all were stressed about. But I think we are blessed and lucky in the fact that we were pretty lightly affected by COVID. My dad had COVID in July last year. He's a chief for Tampa Fire Rescue. So a lot of the firefighters got it, unfortunately. Yeah. So he was one, and he got it pretty rough, but you know, came through it and is fine now for the most part. And you know, knock on wood, he was the only one in our household that got it. You know, we had aunts and uncles that did, but, you know, we're very blessed of we didn't lose anybody because of it. And that's something that is a blessing that I know that there are many that are unfortunately unable to say that. So we definitely are aware of ourselves and the fact that we are still here.
But have you ran into any kind of issues where you know, at a mall, at school, anywhere where someone starts trying to, you know, grab the vest or try to, you know, they clap at the dog or snap their fingers or whatever the heck they're doing, or try to even feed the dog? Like, we've ran into those situations.
Yeah. Definitely pre-COVID, it was very prominent. The first... Oh my gosh. Honestly, probably the first year of college was pretty rough of people just not understanding that no means no, you know, of, oh, can I touch your dog? And I'd be like, no, he's working, but thank you. That's my automatic response is, you know, thanks for asking, but no, he's working. And that was the first year, a lot. I had some people that were like really passive aggressive with me about it, of like, what do you mean? Like, why can't I? And I'm like, because he's a working dog and he's my dog and I can say no. Like, Yes. I'm not going to come up and touch you like without your permission. You're not going to touch my dog, who's an extension of me. I think after the first year and going into the second year of college, people either knew that I wasn't going to say yes or had heard about me enough to stop asking. So it had slowed down a decent amount. And then COVID hit, we didn't go anywhere. And now that we're back in the world with classes and going to the stores and things, I've noticed less people touch him, which I think that's people have learned personal distance because of COVID, which is kind of a blessing in a gray and cloudy year, at least for those of us with service dogs. It seems like people have now learned that you don't touch. So I'll take that. I've only had in the probably last six months, I've probably only had one person touch him without saying anything. And it was a parent on a tour on campus. So it wasn't even a student. It was someone who didn't belong. And I'm like, go back to your state, leave. I know you're not from here, go away. But no, I haven't had anyone try to feed him. I've had family members try to feed him. Like when we're over for holidays and stuff. And I'm like, he doesn't eat people food. He gets watermelon on a blue moon, 95, 100 degree weather day.
I love watermelon.
In Florida. That's all he gets. don't give him anything else.
Yeah. Oh, I lost you for a second. I don't know. It's coming back now. Okay, we're good. Now they love watermelon. Yeah, boy, they go crazy for watermelon. Anyways.
No, Nerf will stare you down, even if it's just any other kind of fruit. It's just fruit. He smells it and he's like, I want it. And he'll just stare at you. And I'm like, you're not getting it. I'm sorry. Not yet. And no.
Right. Only on special occasions. And I hear you. What has been your experience with fake service dogs? You know, we can tell this out. You can tell if a service dog is real and legit, if it's trained, then if it's not. So have you had those experiences?
Yes. I haven't necessarily come into contact with too many of them. Definitely have seen them. I saw a small dog today in Target, actually. That started yipping at Nerf, and Nerf was sitting there hello, you want to play? Cool. And I'm no, Nerf, we're not doing that. Cause Nerf is so friendly. He'll go up to anybody or any animal and be hello. So it's my responsibility as a human to no, we have no idea who this near them. But it's something that we don't necessarily come in contact with them physically, but we see the effects of it. We had very early on in our placement, we had a restaurant that was very iffy about us coming in. And my mom was like, well, you don't have a choice. We're allowed in. We're protected by law because they'd had poor experiences in the past with ill-behaved dogs. So when we went and they were finally fine, I guess, when we went and they saw he just laid and slept, didn't beg for food, wasn't up in people's business. He literally just went under the table and slept. The whole kind of conversation changed, he's so well behaved and da 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 da. And I'm like, yeah, cause he's a service dog. I hear a lot of the commentary when we're at Disney too, of cast members will be like, that's a real service dog. I hear them talking to each other of that's a real service dog. That's how they're supposed to behave. That's what we need to see. And of course I'm like, yes, he is that good. It makes me feel all excited and proud. But that's the thing, is there are situations where they've experienced poor, negative, ill-behaved creatures in the past. And it creates this stereotyping kind of stigma of, ooh, are we going to get the same thing or is this dog different? And, we see it in airports and airplanes. We had a stewardess that just could not stop complimenting him because he was so great, because the flight before had a fake dog and she said it wouldn't stop barking half the flight. So it's something that, they see it all day, every day in their career. You can't help but feel bad for them that they kind of have frustrated outlook. Dogs, not their fault. you know, they are unfortunately having to deal with a lot of the issues and the false narratives that are from these service dogs, quote, you know, very loosely quoted service dogs, or the emotional support animals that, while they have a lovely purpose, people abuse that title and, you know, try to misconstrue it into something that it's not and take advantage of it, which puts those that genuinely need that label of an animal and who go through the proper channels and go through the proper system, do it appropriately of it's within their home, within their business, their residence, whatever that looks like, and they're not trying to go beyond that, it gives them a bad name as well. It's just something that across the whole system of service dogs and emotional support animals, as soon as we have fakes and kind of the quick shop, one and done places, that it just creates problems for the real teams that come later, regardless if it's the next day, the next hour, the next year. It's something that we see it as the consequences of their actions.
So the last question, I know you said he was laying on the bed, so I understand if you don't want him to get up. Is it possible for us to meet Nerf for a minute?
Yeah, let me see. Oh, okay. If he'll come over. Nerfy.
Nerf. Oh, he's right over there. I thought he was in like another room. Okay.
No, we're in my bedroom. Nerf, come here. Come on. He's literally staring at me like, what? Come on. Nerf, off. Hi. Come on. Yeah.
He's knocked out.
Come on. There he goes. We got movement.
How? No, come he's 5 years old now?
Yeah, he turned 5 in March. Come here.
All right, I see him now. Wow, he is a big dog.
Good boy. Yes, he is.
Yeah.
Let's see. Here he is.
He's looking. He's like, what the heck is he staring at doing that for? So he's 5 years old. So does he?
Hey, Buggy.
Do you guys do?
He's like, why am I awake? Why am I moving?
Oh, now he's gone. He said he had enough of that. He said it's time to wrap. Wow, he's really big.
He said, peace out.
Yeah, he's had enough. So do you guys do any kind
he's
of?
Like,
go ahead. No, go ahead.
Oh, I just said he's like 64 pounds.
You know, Leigh, I really appreciate everything you've told people. And you really, really went into depth, not only about your situation, but CCI in general. Again, CCI.org. Definitely check it out. These people that are breeders, that are puppy raisers, they put their own money in out of their own pockets. They're not getting anything. And they give people that need these animals, and also the animals need them, of course. They get it for free. There's no money out of the pockets of the people that are getting these amazing animals to help them in their own lives. So it's really an incredible organization, really worth a donate. You know, you don't have to donate a ton of money, but if you can donate $5, $10, it goes to helping out. And if you go on Amazon and you do buy stuff, you can do Amazon Smile, and they do give money to CCI as far as a donation to a charitable organization. I do that also if I have to buy something off Amazon. So, Leigh, I appreciate everything you've done. We've talked for almost an hour, and I appreciate the time. I love the conversation. It was amazing. And I wish you luck, and I hope we continue this conversation down the road and definitely do this again. Because you are truly amazing, and I know Nerf is too. I know he's just a little tired and he wants to relax right now, so we give him the time. But Leigh, thanks so much. I appreciate you, seriously.
Absolutely. Thank you for reaching out. It was definitely fun.